Good evening, everybody. It's good to see you tonight. Let's all stand together. Lord Jesus, we're so thankful for the opportunity to come into your house tonight. Lord, we thank you for the many blessings that you pour out on our lives. And Lord, we're just blessed to be able to call on your name tonight. Lord, recognizing that at the name of Jesus, all the demons in hell will tremble. Lord, we're so thankful tonight for that matchless name. There's power, there's healing, there's hope in the name of Jesus. We worship you tonight, Lord. Have your way in our hearts as we lift you up. In Jesus' name, amen. Jesus, your name is power. Jesus, your name is power. That verse again. Jesus, your name is power.
Jesus, your name is power. Jesus, your name is mine. Jesus, your name will break every stronghold.
Victory declared.
There's power in the name of Jesus. God, we're so thankful tonight, Lord, that we can call on your matchless name, recognizing the power that is held just within the name of Jesus. The miracle-working power, the healing power. Lord Jesus, we're so thankful tonight, Lord, that you are a God who heals and that you're a God who loves us and a God who cares for us at all times. And Lord, we're just thankful to be here tonight as a family of God, that we've been able to gather to worship you and to hear the teaching of your word. But God, right now, we pray that you would just speak to our hearts as we continue. Lord, we're just so thankful. We love you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Are you thankful tonight, church? We have so much to be thankful for. I want you to think about one thing that you're thankful for right now, and I want you to turn to your neighbor. Tell them your name if you haven't met them before, and tell them that one thing that you're thankful for tonight.
There's power in the name of Jesus. There is hope, there is strength, and victory to claim. There's healing in his holy presence. There is power in his name. Yes, there is power.
Seated for just a few minutes. I hope tonight that you come here that you can all say that you found your hope, and that you found your hope in Christ Jesus. Because if you've tried to find your hope in other things, you can testify along with me that those things end up at a dead end. But when we put our hope in Christ Jesus, that's where we can find rest, where we can find peace. You know, I've not always been at the place where I found my hope in Christ. Just as many of us do, we try so many other things and so many other people and put our faith in maybe in a job and in a relationship. But our hope needs to be in Jesus Christ, because that's where we find peace. You know, I was doing a little reading and researching today and thinking about some of the things that God allows us to do. And three of the honors that we have been given by God, one of the things is that we have been given the opportunity to occupy a place in God's heart. Think about that. Those of us that called on the name of Jesus, we have an opportunity to occupy a place in his heart. You know, we have a divine purpose for living. As soon as our eyes pop open in the morning, I have a purpose. Aren't you thankful for that? That you have a purpose tonight? And the third thing that I was thinking about today, you know, we have an opportunity to join God where he's working. So we get to occupy a place in his heart. We get to have a divine purpose for living. And we get to join God where he's working. Folks, it doesn't get any better than that. How can you have a bad day when you think about that? God is good, and all my hope is in Him. I invite you to listen as we sing this song.
Hallelujah.
washed by the blood.
Let's all stand and sing this together.
Are you washed in the blood, in the soul cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Let's sing it out together.
Calls the sons and daughters. We are ransomed by our.
Aren't you thankful that yesterday is gone?
Amen.
And all my sins are forgiven. I've been washed by the blood. Can we just put our hands together tonight and thank Jesus that yesterday is gone and that we've been washed by the blood of the Lamb. Hallelujah. Thank you so much. You can be seated.
Oh, can you say amen, church? I'm always impressed by people who can play the piano, and I'm always impressed by people who can sing. And I don't know what to say about people that can play and can sing. I think that's too much talent for one person, and then preach a three-point sermon while they're playing and they're singing. So, good night. Heather, I walked in and thought it was Kayla up here and almost came running over to give her a hug. Not that we're not happy to see you, but I hope you take that as a compliment, all right? Who's glad to be in church tonight? Amen? Amen. It's good to see you, and it's good to come and to worship the Lord and to honor the Lord and to lift Him up. And Heather, to continue to, I call you Kayla most of the time, and I call her Heather most of the time, so there you go. I want you to turn in your Bibles to the Gospel of Luke, if you will, the Gospel of Luke, and go to chapter 23, the Gospel of Luke, chapter 23. And so, you know, we're moving along. It's October, hard to believe, is it not? It's October, and the Lord has been so good and so kind and so gracious to us in these Wednesday services that we've been having. And what I have tried to do and what I have on my heart for a season, and we'll just go until the Lord says to stop, is to deliver messages that were on my heart as I traveled and preached revivals. I've jokingly called these revival ramblings with the Reverend, and so tonight we're going to look at one in Luke 23. This is one of the most, to me, unique passages concerning the life of Jesus. Do you know when you study the life of Christ and when you study the Gospels, there are some books that you can get, for example, that are what is called a harmony of the Gospels. And what it does is it'll take the four Gospels and it'll lay them side by side, and it'll trace the steps of Jesus in chronological order. Harold Wilmington, who is my favorite Bible teacher, he's in heaven now, but was my main Bible teacher when I was going through Bible college. Harold Wilmington did a section on From Glory to Glory, and what he did was he traced the steps of Jesus, 1, 2, 3, in chronological order, all through the four Gospels. It's a remarkable study, one of the most amazing that I've gone through, that traces the steps of Christ. And what's unique, again, one of the reasons I think it's so important for us to take the Bible in context is one of the main reasons that I can give to us is it keeps us from focusing on what are our pet subjects, our pet topics. What I've learned about so many people in American Christianity is that we have our pet doctrines, our pet topics, the things that we like to talk about, the things we like to focus on. I made a little joke in passing. I don't remember if it was this Sunday or last Sunday. You get that way, do you not, when you can't remember which Sunday it was? But I made a joke sort of in passing about how Jesus turned water into wine and how so many people don't know John 3:16, but they know He turned water into wine. They don't know why He turned water into wine. They don't know what He did before or what He did after. They just know He turned water into wine. And I had a lady a long time ago, I sort of threw this out when I mentioned it, but I had a lady a long time ago, a lady or a man, I don't remember. Let's say a man. Let's leave you ladies alone for a little while. There was a man that he said, see, Jesus turned the water into wine. You know, okay, what does that mean? Jesus turned the water into wine. And so what he was saying was, that means it's okay to get a drink. I said, sure, man. He goes, you agree? I said, sure. Whenever you find the wine Jesus made, help yourself, you know. But what we do is, watch, is we... if we're not careful, we know just enough Bible to make us dangerous. And so what we do is we have our presuppositions. And just to give you a little difference here, there's eisegesis and exegesis. And eisegesis is when what we do, watch, is we impose our thoughts on the Bible. All right? Now let me give an example. Who's listening? Say amen. Well, I believe in eternal security. Preacher, okay, what's that mean? Well, it means once saved, always saved. Okay, where is that in the Bible? Well, I don't know. That's just what I believe. And see how quiet you are? Okay, so do I believe in eternal security? Yes. Sure do. But let me ask you this, can you back it up in the Bible? All right? You heard about the preacher that said, I got a good sermon, I just need some Bible to go along with this? And that's what we do. Yes or no? That's eisegesis. What we do is we've got our mind made up. We've heard things through tradition, through growing up in church. Let me give a couple of examples. Y'all look like y'all are interested in this, all right? The Bible says, spare the rod, spoil the child. No, it doesn't. And that's going to ruin you. You're not going to sleep at all tonight. You're going to be up all night. You're going to be looking. Just write these things down. You go look them up afterwards. Spare the rod, spoil the child. It does not say that. As a matter of fact, it says, he that spareth the rod hateth his son. That's what it says. It does not say, spare the rod, spoil the child. But we think it says, spare the rod, spoil the child, because we've heard that. Okay, God will never put more on you than you can bear. I mean, we believe that, right? The Bible says, no, the Bible does not say that. It does not even come anywhere close to saying that. It says, there's no temptation taking you but that which is common to man, but God is able, who will with the temptation make a way of escape that you may be able to bear it. Study that word temptation. He's not talking about troubles and trials and difficulties and things of that nature. Are you all listening? Say amen. So there's a lot of things we think the Bible says. It's amazing when, you know, let the Bible get in the way, right? When you read the Bible, here's one. Cleanliness is next to godliness. I mean, people think that's in the Bible, right? And you ought to take a good bath, yes or no? I mean, but the Bible does not say that. It does not say that anywhere. And so we could just keep going. I mean, we could just keep talking about what we think the Bible says. That's eisegesis. We've got our mind made up. We've got our presuppositions. Don't confuse me with the facts. Don't bother me with the facts. I know what I believe, and nothing you say is going to change my mind or make a difference. And what we do is we impose those thoughts on the Bible. Well, I know it says it somewhere in the Bible. It's got to be in the Bible. That's not right. And then there's exegesis, and what that means is to lift from, to exegete, to lift. That means just let the Bible speak. So all of that to try to get us to this point of Luke 23, and here it is. When you study the Bible, you will be very amazed to discover how little is spoken concerning the early days of Jesus. Very little is spoken concerning his early days. As a matter of fact, if you took all of the verses in the four Gospels that related to the early days of Jesus, you'd be hard-pressed to put a chapter together. You probably could get a chapter. You'd be very, very, very tough to get two. There's just a few things spoken about his early days. The majority of the Gospels lend themselves to the 3.5-year earthly ministry, and what's even more interesting than that to me is how much of it lends itself to the final 1 year in the life of Jesus Christ. And so when you come to Luke 23, I mean, we're in these final days. We're in this final week. And so much of the gospel talks about that. Now, why am I making that point? Because you've got to ask yourself, is it important to you or is it important to God? There's a lot of things that are important to you, that are important to us, that are important to people here, that are not as important to God. So when you read your Bible, amen? Now, this is October. Let's keep going, folks, all of you that are on the journey to read the Bible through. And for those of you that are not, then in November, we've got more of those Bibles. Thank the Lord. We finally got them off that shipping container that was out in the ocean. We got it here. And we're going to have them out in November, and you can get ready to buy your Every Day with Jesus Bible, and we're going to get everyone to read the Bible through. And we're going to help each other when we get to Leviticus. Can you say amen to that? Amen? We're going to encourage each other because, 85% of people that set out to read the Bible through in a year stop when they get to Leviticus. The Georgia preacher called it Leviticus, but nevertheless, we're going to get through it together. We're going to help each other. Amen? And we're going to learn what's important to God, not what's important to us. And we're going to lay aside tradition. Listen, there's a difference in preferences and convictions, all right? And a conviction comes from the Word of God. Your preference is your opinion of the Word of God. And you better be careful to make sure that what you're standing for is biblical, not your idea of what the Bible says, because there's a big difference. All right, amen. Do we need to sing some more? Are we all okay? Amen? All right, pass the offering plate. What do we need to do? Amen? All right, so Luke 23, we're in the final days of Jesus, and I want you to look at verse 6. When Pilate heard of Galilee... Now, just quickly, let me tell you what's going on. Jesus is being sent to stand before Pontius Pilate. Do you remember this? And here he is before Pilate, and Pilate is examining him. And three times he says, I find no fault in this man. And Pilate, willing to content the people, he was a true politician. He cared about opinion polls, and he cared about public opinion, and he wanted to please the people. And so he heard of Galilee. He asked whether the man were a Galilean. And as soon as he knew that he belonged to Herod's jurisdiction... Okay, so here's what's going on. Pilate is examining Jesus. He finds no fault in him. The crowd's mad. They're angry. They want to do away with him. And all of a sudden, he hears what he thinks is a loophole. He learns that he may be a Galilean, and so he asks him, and then he finds out that he's from Herod's jurisdiction. What does he do? Verse 7, he dismisses him, sends him to Herod, who himself was at Jerusalem at that time. Why did Pilate do this? Pilate did this because, watch, he was doing everything he could to get rid of Jesus, to evade him, to avoid him. He wanted someone else to deal with it. I don't want blood on my hands. I don't want to have to deal with Jesus. I don't want to have to make a judgment. Let Herod deal with him. So he sends him to Herod. Now, there are a couple of Herods in the Bible, four in the Gospels, two surrounding the life of Jesus, one at his birth, one at his death. This was a man by the name of Herod Antipas, and he was quite an individual. He was a vicious ruler. He was a wicked politician. He was an adulterer, and we could say much about that. That may be important here in a few moments. But he took his sister-in-law, his brother's wife, to himself and committed adultery with her. And so here, I mean, Herod, who in the room is listening? Herod was not someone that we'd invite to come preach at Bible conference. Do you get it? He's not a cool dude. And verse 8, when Herod saw Jesus, so now why is Jesus coming? Because Pilate sends him. You get it? He's standing before Pilate. Pilate wants to get rid of him. When Herod saw Jesus, he was exceeding glad. Now, the phrase exceeding glad means jump for joy. So what I'm trying to say with all due respect is Herod's more excited about seeing Jesus than most Baptists are when they get to church. Because exceeding glad is not in most of our vocabulary. I mean, he's jumping for joy. He's turning flips. I mean, this guy's fired up. Now, how do you reconcile this? Wicked leader, wicked political leader, wicked ungodly adulterer, and yet he's jumping for joy when Jesus comes. So the Bible says when Herod saw Jesus, he was exceeding glad because he was desirous to see him of a long season. In other words, watch, he had waited for this day for so long, that's why he was so excited. I mean, you know, when you wait for something for a long time, it's exciting, yes or no? Okay, let me jog some of your memories. When you wait for your wedding day, amen? Well, that's a good day. Amen? That was a good day, huh? As long as you're nodding, I'm okay, all right? Man, when you wait for Christmas, yes or no? I mean, boy, that's just exciting, right? When you wait for LSU, A&M, so that LSU can beat them, man, that's exciting, right? All right, got a few folks here. Man, we're getting some more Louisiana connection in this church. I need some backup, all right? Okay, you get it. He was exceeding glad. Why? He was desirous to see him of a long season because he had heard many things of him, and he hoped to have seen a miracle done by him. So he questioned with him. Now, what's going on is Herod is questioning Jesus, verse 9, in many words. And then here's the most unique, one of the most unique statements in the Bible. Verse 9, but he answered him nothing. Now, let me ask you a question. If you walked up to me and just started rattling off questions and I just stood there and ignored you and didn't answer, would you consider that rude? Would you? Yes, you would. Yeah. So could you imagine going to Jesus and just rattling off question after question after question? I mean, he's the epitome of love, right or wrong. I mean, God in human flesh, he loves us, yes? And here's Herod asking him questions, literally interrogating him and questioning him with many words. And Jesus answers him nothing. Nothing means not one single word. Never opens his mouth. Seemingly rude, dismissive at best. And the chief priest and scribe stood and vehemently accused him, verse 10. And Herod with his men of war set him at naught. They mocked him, and they arrayed him in a gorgeous robe. Do you see this? They're making fun of him, and they sent him back to Pilate. And verse 12 says, the same day Pilate and Herod were made friends together because before they were at enmity or at odds between themselves. Now, what's the point of this story? Very quickly, and let's go through it. Herod and Pilate do not like each other. They're enemies. They hate each other. They despise each other. But according to verse 12, because of this brief and momentous encounter that Jesus had with Herod, they're made friends together. Do you find it interesting that groups that hate each other become friends because they hate something else more? And we see that with a lot of groups in our country, yes or no? I mean, this group hates this group, hates this group, hates this group, but they all hate Jesus more. And the one thing they can find common ground on to come together and to bully is to beat up on Christians and beat up on churches and beat up on the Word of God and beat up on you Bible thumpers and you fundamentalists and you crazy people and on and on and on. I mean, they're out here fighting each other, suing each other, hating each other. But what they all stop to come together in agreement is in their opposition towards Christians and Christ and the blood of Jesus Christ? Yes or no? I mean, folks, you could gather, and tell me if I'm telling the truth. You could gather and talk about the Quran all day long, and nobody gets offended, nobody gets upset. You could talk about Muhammad and Allah all you want, and I mean, you know, they just sit there and sing Kumbaya. But when you talk about Jesus Christ, God in human flesh, who was born of a virgin, who knew no sin, who became sin on a cross, who shed his precious red royal blood to wash us clean of our sin, died on a cross, was buried in a borrowed tomb, arose on the third day. I mean, folks start shaking. They get upset. They get mad. They don't like that. And so here's Pilate and Herod. They're brought together. They're made friends. Before they were at odds, the Bible tells us, but now they're made friends. A couple of quick things we won't take long that I want to look at as it relates to this passage and to this very unique story in the final days of Jesus. Number one, I want to talk to you about the anticipation of Jesus by Herod. I'm sorry, but I just simply am really smitten by this thought. Pilate sends him to Herod, and the Bible says, when Herod sees him, he's exceeding glad. I just cannot state enough how important that is and how significant that is. It says to us, when Herod saw Jesus, do you see him? I mean, he looks up, regular day, normal day, all of a sudden, Pilate sends him to Herod. Herod comes into his courts. Herod looks up and sees him. He's exceeding glad, jumping for joy. I mean, he's like a kid at Christmas, a kid in a candy shop. He is overjoyed, overwhelmed. He is just absolutely taken aback in the anticipation of Jesus by Herod. How do you explain that? A wicked man, an adulterous man, an ungodly man, an infamous wicked ruler. How do you explain this? How do you reconcile these two thoughts? One of these things is not like the other. This wicked person comes to meet Jesus. Jesus comes into his courts, and this man's just excited, thrilled. Well, notice what it says. When Herod saw Jesus, he was exceeding glad. Why? Because he was desirous to see him of a long season. I mean, he had waited, he had hoped, he had anticipated this meeting for so long that because he anticipated it for so long, when it finally happened, he just couldn't contain his emotion. He was so excited. I mean, he was just so thrilled. So let's ask and answer a quick question before we move on, all right? Why was he so excited to see Jesus? Why was he waiting for such a long time to see him? Let me point out two reasons verse 8 gives us. Number one, it says, because he had heard many things about him. So in other words, he had heard so much about him that when the day came that Jesus showed up, he was jumping for joy. If you're getting this, say amen. And he just could not contain the joy within because he had heard so much about him. Okay, quick question. How did Herod hear so much about Jesus? I don't know if you know this or not. Forgive me for being crazy. They didn't have cell phones in those days. They didn't have live stream. Right? Herod didn't say, well, I'll just stay home, watch this online. I'll get the app. I'll get the podcast. I'll listen to it. Right or wrong? He didn't get online and watch him. So how in the world did Herod hear so much about Jesus? Let me let you in on a little secret. You ready for it? When you study the New Testament, you will discover something interesting about Herod. Herod had, I guess you'd call it a favorite pastime, and that is he loved to listen to a man preach. Do you believe that? Herod enjoyed the preaching of a man by the name of John the Baptist. You ever heard of John the Baptist? Have you ever heard of John the Baptist? Who would like John the Baptist to come preach at MEMS? You better be careful. You better watch out. He may would thin the crowd out, yes or no? I mean, unique wardrobe. That'd be the first thing we'd have a hard time with, right or not? Could you see everyone posting on social media? You folks be out there taking pictures. Look at here. Look at what he's wearing. Can you believe this guy wore it behind the pulpit? John the Baptist. Then you'd talk about his diet. I mean, the guy's eating locust and honey. Well, you better put honey on locust if you're going to eat it, yes or no? And so here's John the Baptist, man. I mean, yes, sir. I mean, my goodness gracious. He's preaching repentance. And the more he preached and the harder he preached, Herod loved it. Herod loved it. Herod loved it. So much so, watch, that he heard so much about who John the Baptist preached concerning that when Jesus showed up, he was familiar with him. But when John the Baptist started preaching on adultery, Herod was not so sure that he liked that. Not every time, but sometimes folks get mad at the preacher. It's because, like what my dad used to say, when you throw a handful of rocks and a pack of dogs, the one you hit, or the one that yelps, is the one you hit. And John the Baptist was so fired up and was so true to preaching the truth, when he started hitting close to home, Herod got so mad. Let's just fast forward a little bit. It cost him his head. Are you listening? And some preachers out there that are getting their head cut off, figuratively, by church folk who are more like Herod, because they don't want to hear the truth. And I'm just telling you, we're going to have to decide if we're interested in being biblically correct or politically correct. Because if you follow that political correctness crowd, well, they just, I'm surprised they haven't come out with, well, they probably have, the politically correct Bible. And we got gender neutral, and we can't refer to God as he, because that offends people. Yes or no? Whew, good night, man. I want to just go off on this for about an hour, Brother Allen, and talk about it. Listen, folks, this man loved to listen to the preaching of John. You know what I know? There's a lot of folks that love preaching. I can't tell you, folks, that I have met through the years, that they'll get up in the morning, get in their easy chair, get their remote, and they'll watch one preacher right after the next, 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 and they just watch their preacher's preacher. I'll get up and I read my daily devotion, and then I listen to this preacher, and I listen to that preacher, and I listen to this preacher and that preacher, and I just love preaching. Nothing wrong with loving preaching. You better love the one we're preaching about. And hear me, Herod was familiar with Jesus, so much so that Jesus did not need an introduction. He knew who he was because he had heard about him through the preaching of John the Baptist, the man he loved to hear preach. He was familiar with him. Second reason, the anticipation of Jesus by Herod. Why was he so excited to see him? Because he was fascinated by him. Not only was he familiar with him, he was fascinated by him. Look at verse 8. When Herod saw Jesus, he was exceeding glad because he was desirous to see him of a long season. Why? Here it is. He heard many things of him, and he hoped to have seen a miracle done by him. So in other words, of the things he heard, one of the things he heard among all of the others was he heard he was able to do miracles, right? And so Herod was like, I mean, do you see him? I mean, he's smiling. He's excited. He's like, Jesus is going to come into my courts. He is going to perform a miracle. And I can't wait. What's he going to do? Maybe he's going to turn water into wine. Maybe, I mean, who knows what he's going to do? I cannot wait for him to get here and do a miracle. He was fascinated by him. And you know what I've learned? There's a lot of people fascinated with Jesus. I mean, they like when Jesus does stuff for them. Yes, sir. Who's listening? Say amen. Now, let me get off into a couple of things and just, you know, man, I'm in a good mood tonight, so let's just go with it, right? Man, I eat good today. I feel good today. Let's go. Are you ready? Do y'all remember reading years and years ago? And I'm not trying to be ugly. I want you, would you listen to my heart, and would you listen, please, to what I'm trying to say? Would you listen to what I'm saying and choose to not listen to what I'm not saying? There's a difference. You awake, say amen. Some of y'all are thinking about that. Do you remember years ago, and I cannot remember where it was, and it doesn't matter, but do you remember they were having these services, and they were publicizing them, and people were coming from everywhere because they were saying that when they would get into the presence of the Lord, gold dust would appear on their lapels. Do you remember reading about this and hearing about this? Now, just listen. Just before you get mad, throw something at me, listen. And then there were some people that were being interviewed by reporters, and they were saying that they were going to church and they were leaving with gold teeth, gold filling, because God was showing up and the best thing that I ever heard about that in my life was this. And so before you start, just put it in park, listen. The best thing I ever heard was a preacher friend of mine was preaching about that one night, and he said, let me tell you one thing, and I need you to listen to this statement, church. He said, if you and I were really in a service where God himself really did come down and we had really been in his presence and we got out to the car and gold dust was on our lapel, after being in the presence of God, here's what we'd do. Gold dust. And we'd go on. Because there is nothing as precious as him. There is nothing as important as him. There is nothing higher than him. There is nothing greater. Not an experience, not an emotion, nothing. Not gold teeth. Can I get a witness from anyone? Amen? Okay, does our God do miracles? You better believe he does. However, there is something greater than a miracle, and his name is Jesus. And Herod was fascinated by him because he wanted someone to come in and entertain the crowd and entertain him. Maybe he was going to sell tickets. I don't know. Maybe he was going to charge for admission. I'm not sure. But I'm telling you, shame on any of us that take the glory of God and attempt to monopolize on it. God is a jealous God, and he will share his glory with no one. No preacher, no person, no ministry, no church, no one in this room. He is greater, he is higher, he is bigger, he is larger. He is God. And Herod is so excited to meet Jesus because he's familiar with him and he's fascinated by him. And I think all of you that know me, good night, you know I get excited and I get stirred up. And man, I've seen a lot of things I've never seen a Baptist die of excitement. Who knows what I'm talking about? Amen? I'm trying to get us more excited, okay? But at the end of the day, we don't need cheerleaders to stir us up on Sundays or Wednesdays. We've got him. We don't need anyone to get up on stage and say, give us a J, give us an E, give us an S, give us a U, give us an S. What's that spell? Jesus. I've got spirit. Yes, I do. I've got spirit. How about you? We've got more. We've got more. We've got more. We don't need pom-poms. When the Holy Spirit is here, he's all we need. Amen? He's the one that fascinates us. He's the one that moves us. He's the one that stirs us. He's it. Whew. Well, come on Wednesday night. You never know what you're going to hear. Amen? The anticipation of Jesus by Herod. Why? He was familiar and fascinated. Secondly, watch this quickly. Verse 9. There's the inspection of Jesus by Herod. Well, Jesus is standing before Herod, and look at what happens, verse 9. He questioned him with many words, but he answered him nothing. I mean, simple verse. There's two parts to it. Herod questions Jesus, and Jesus' response is nothing. The inspection of Jesus by Herod. Two points. Watch it. Firstly, there's the request. So here's Herod, he's interrogating him. Do you see him? He questioned with him in many words. Many words. Many words. Help, I'm talking and I cannot shut up. I mean, Herod just keeps going, just keeps going, just keeps going, just keeps going. He's questioning him with many, many words. Don't try that at home. Don't ever tell anyone that, all right? I'm talking and I can't shut up. And so he says to him, he questions him with many words. Who in the room has ever been around someone you try to talk to him about? Do you know the Lord? And all of a sudden they become a theologian. You ever been around someone like that? Hey, let me, you know, they're just talking and they're talking about the stock market and they're talking about ball and they're just, you know, happy-go-lucky running their mouth. And all of a sudden, you know, you just throw the big question on them. Hey, look, if you don't mind me asking, if you were to die right now, do you know for sure you'd go to heaven? And all of a sudden they change and their voice gets deeper. And they say, you know, well, I was thinking about that. I've got a question for you. Where did Cain get his wife? That's where you go? We're talking about heaven. You want to talk about Cain's wife? That's really where you go, really? Well, where did Cain get his wife? Well, why are you so interested in another man's wife? If I told you I don't know, what would you say? If I told you the real answer, would you get mad and not want to talk about it? Or would you ask another question like, can God make a rock so big that even he can't lift it? Or then maybe you would throw in the good one, why do bad things happen to good people? Who in the room is listening? Say amen. Not all questions are smoke screens, but many are a smoke screen to cover up the real issue, which is, I do not want to repent. So I'll continue to ask questions, questions, questions to deflect, to deter. So he questions him with many words. He interrogates him. Do you see it? The request. Then let me give you the response. Verse 9. Then he questioned him in many words, but he answered him nothing. I need you to say that out loud. I need y'all to participate with me. Verse 9, that last part, but he answered him nothing. Could we say that together? Let's go. But he answered him nothing. Say it again. But he answered. Yeah. You've got to let that get into you because I'm telling you, that doesn't really sound like the Jesus that you and I know. And it doesn't really sound like the Jesus, does it not mean right? It does not really sound like the Jesus that you and I talk about in love and worship. Jesus, I mean, here he is, right? Let me ask you this. Does Jesus desire for everyone to be saved? Yes or no? He's not willing that any would perish, but all would come to repentance. True or false? God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son whosoever. Yes, absolutely. And so here he is standing before Herod. Herod's all excited to see him. And so he just starts questioning him. And Jesus just stands there. Now, don't add to it. I mean, there's no indication that he's insulting him. There's no indication that he's being sarcastic. He just refuses to answer. He doesn't say a word, doesn't open his mouth. He's silent. And I'm telling you, listen, when you, maybe that doesn't do for you what it does for me. I don't know. But that just shakes me. That shakes me. And I don't mean this irreverent and I don't mean this ugly, but it just makes me want to ask, do you not care about Herod? You remember the woman at the well? Did he speak to her, yes or no? And then she goes, what are you, a man, what are you, a Jew, doing talking to me? He said, if you knew who it was that was talking to you, you would ask for living water and you'd get water and you'd never thirst again. I'm telling you, he talked. Do you remember Nicodemus came to Jesus at night, Nick at night? I mean, do you remember that? Give you a little something, all right, to take home. Nicodemus, do you remember that? Rabbi, we know you are a teacher come from God, for no man can do the miracles that you do unless God be with him. And Jesus said, you must be born again. I mean, the woman at the well, the woman taken in the act of adultery, you remember her? You remember her? Those men went and found a woman. How would you know where to go to find a woman taken in the act of adultery? You listen to it getting quiet, see? You want to know why? Because they'd been there before. You want to talk about that a minute? So they go get her and they drag her before the Lord. Do you see? And they're now Moses in the law said that such should be stoned, but what do you say? Jesus stooping down just started, you remember that? He just started writing and he said, okay, he's without sin. And if you read it in the Greek, it reads, he's he that's without the same sin. When you're so quick to judge another's motives, it's because you reveal your own heart. So the reason they went and grabbed that gal is because they'd been there before. All right. Be careful when you jump on the bandwagon of condemning other people. So, you know, from the eldest to the youngest, they all leave. He turns and says, where are your accusers? She said, there are none, sir. He said, neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. Grace and truth. Do you like that? Go. Who's thankful for go? And from this moment on, stop sinning. Truth. He spoke to her. Guys, you, everyone Jesus encountered, he talked to. You say, well, he didn't talk to Pilate. He did talk to Pilate until the question was asked, what is truth? But then after that. So let's just let it sink in for a minute. We're almost done. How do you and I reconcile the Son of God refusing to speak to someone? How do you and I refuse this Savior that we know, that we love, that we worship, that we tell others about? If you'll just come and give your life to him, there's nothing you've done. You're not too far gone. God will save you. It's true, right? How do we reconcile this? And yet he stands before Jesus and he asks him questions and Jesus answers him nothing. Question, and then we're going to pray. Why was Jesus silent to Herod? You say, well, he knew Herod's motives and he knew that his motives were not sincere. Okay, true. Well, he knew that Herod was not going to listen to it, and so he didn't cast his pearl before swine. Okay, true. But let me give you what I have found and what I believe to be the reason from the best I can gather studying the scripture, and here it is, and we're going to bring this plane in for a landing and we're done. And let me just say before I tell you, there's nothing that bothers me more than when God does not talk to me. It does not bother me when God talks to me. It bothers me when he's silent to me. When I pray and who's listening? When I pray and pray and pray and pray and I'm hearing nothing, that bothers me. And there are seasons, and I get it, and it's not always this way, but I just want to give you one reason, and we'll go home, okay? Okay, preacher. Jesus in his silence was saying to Herod, if you love to listen to the preaching of John the Baptist and yet you're unwilling to do anything with what you hear, until you obey the light I give you, there's no more light coming. And because of your stubborn refusal and unwillingness to listen to the truth that's been graciously given to you, I will not give more truth to you, because to whom much is given, much is required. And if all you do is sit and listen to John the Baptist, and you're fascinated and enamored by his preaching, but you don't listen to what he's saying, because John the Baptist pointed to me and said, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." And had you listened to John the Baptist, it would have led you to the reality that I am the Messiah and I have come to die for you to set you free. And because of your stubborn refusal to listen to the truth that I've given to you, the reason I'm silent to you is in my silence, I'm saying to you, I've already spoken, and until you obey what I've said, there's nothing else to say. So let me just, this is going to get real serious. This is too serious for Wednesday night. I should have saved this for Sunday morning. Amen? If I preach this on Sunday morning sometime, will y'all act like you've never heard it before? Will you do it? Will you do that? Just will you do it for me? All right, here it is. You ready? If you simply come to church to sit, check a box, listen to the Bible, and be entertained, you are heaping condemnation upon yourself. And the most damnable, dangerous thing that you can do for yourself is to sit under biblical teaching and biblical truth with no heart and no intention to obey it. Because I'm telling you, if you continue to hear the word and not obey the word, you will eventually get to the point where there's nothing else for God to say. And here's what it'll lead to, and I won't take any time on this. The third one, the rejection of Jesus by Herod. Because watch this, when you hear truth and you walk away, let me show you something. Watch. When the light comes on and you turn from the light, the only other alternative is to walk in darkness. And the darkest of dark are those whose light is darkness. Jesus said that. And so when you think you're in the light, but it's really darkness, that's dark. And I'm going to tell you what I've seen. I got to watch myself. Through my years of traveling to churches, the hardest churches I've been in are churches that, you know, years ago had revival. And the truth was so poured out, and they chose to walk away from it. And when you turn from the light and walk away from the light, the only option is to walk in darkness. And I'm just telling you, as your pastor, it's a dangerous thing to continue to go to Bible studies, 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 services, 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 and have no heart to obey what he says. God does not speak to entertain us. God does not speak to fascinate us. He wants to move us. And when we hear truth, the only option is yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Trust and obey. Trust and obey. Hear from him, follow him. Hear from him, obey him. Hear from him, obey him. Who in the room's listening? Say amen. And I think that in American Christianity, there are a lot of people that church is a sport. It's a sport to them. Do you hear what I'm saying? I'm not saying this to be rude or ugly. Guys, you hear my heart. If I didn't love you, we'd just rock you to sleep. I'm telling you, because I love you, don't expose yourself to the Bible and then not obey it. Don't come in here, are you listening? Don't hear Bible truth and then not obey it. To whom much is given, much is required. Why was Jesus silent? Because he was literally screaming in his silence to Herod, "You've not obeyed what I've told you." Don't you think God knows if we're going to do anything with what he tells us? Yes or no? Preacher, man, I wish. Look. Preacher, if God would show me what to do, I would do it. That's not the way this works. It's God, I'll do it. Now you show me what to do. And God always wants us to be, look, surrendered and obedient before he reveals what he wants us to do. Amen. Y'all like to go to Luby's around here. And, you know, Luby, you remember Piccadilly? I mean, you go to these cafeterias and you pick and choose what you want. And there's a lot of people that want to do that with this book right here, with the Bible. I'll pick some of this. I don't believe I want that. That tithing part, shh, shh, shh. Don't talk about that. I don't want to hear that a tenth of my earning ought to go to the Lord. Don't, shh. Don't talk about that. Forgive. Stop. Turn the other cheek. Don't you talk about that, preacher. That guy looked at me wrong, I'm going to slap him. Don't talk to me about turn the other cheek. You know, to him that curses you, bless and curse not, speak what? No, I don't want to do that. For one that compels you to go a mile, go another mile. I don't want to do that. I want to do the least I can do to get by. Are you guys listening? And I'm just telling you, we've got to come and say, Lord, give me the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. And where I need to change, Lord, have your way. I'm willing to surrender and change. And all the people in the house said amen. Amen? Amen? So here's the question. We're going to pray. If you find that you're going through a season in your life where God is silent to you, it doesn't always mean this, but you need to at least consider tonight that one of the reasons may be you did not do the last thing he told you to do. And until you go back and do the last thing he told you to do, y'all okay? Amen? Would you bow your heads with me tonight? Let's pray. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Heavenly Father, it is a joy and a privilege to be together in your house. It is a privilege and an honor to come before you and to worship you. And, oh Lord, we know your word is so alive, it's rich, it's powerful, it's relevant to tonight, to what we're going through, to what we're walking through, to what we're living in our own lives, in our own homes and families. And in the name of Jesus, I'm asking you tonight to help us to not be just hearers of the word, but to be doers of the word, to listen to what you say, and then to, when you say it, Lord, to do it. I mean, immediately, at once, to obey all the way, to obey right away, and to do exactly what you're saying. And so, Lord, whatever it is that you have told us to do that we're struggling with, and we've been tripping over it, and we've been trying to skirt the issue, and we've been trying to go in another direction. We know in our heart, God, we know in our heart, we know that you're calling us, that you're wooing us, that you're beckoning us, that you're speaking to us. And sometimes, Lord, we're convinced that we know better than you, and we know a better way, and our way's better than your way. And I'm asking you tonight in the name of Jesus to just settle down in this place and move all around this building, in and through each pew, each heart, each life. Start with mine. Soften our heart, Lord, to the truth of your word, and help us not become so cold and callous to truth that we've heard again and again that we just think, yeah, I know, I know, I know, I know. But Lord, go deep, deep, deep into the recesses of our heart and get everything out of us that doesn't belong there and put everything in us that does belong there. And help us just at once tonight to obey, to instantly obey, to instantaneously obey. And whatever that means in our heart and our life tonight, may we be faithful to you and to your word. So wash over us tonight. Speak to us. Challenge us. Change us. Convict us. We give you the glory and the honor in the name of Jesus. Now for just a moment, heads are bowed, eyes are closed. We're not going to take long, but if the Lord is speaking to you tonight, maybe an area where you know he's been trying to get your attention, he's been trying to speak to you, you've been hearing him, and for whatever reason, you've just found it difficult to submit, to surrender, to let go, to trust him, to turn it over to him, to say, Lord, I give up my right, and I give it to you, and I trust you. Whatever it is that's going on in this struggle, in this turmoil within, that tonight would just lead you to say, Lord, I'm surrendering everything. And whatever the last thing was the Lord told you to do that you've yet to do, tonight would you just be willing to get alone with the Lord where you're seated, kneel at your pew, kneel at the altar, whatever it is you need to do just between you and the Lord to say, Lord, I want to obey you. I want to obey you. I want to obey all of the word, and I want the word to be the judge of my life and every single area of my life from the crown of my head to the sole of my feet that does not line up with your word. I'm asking you to put your finger on it, and I'm asking you to challenge me and convict me and change me to the glory of God for your honor. I want to obey you. I want to join you where you're at work, as Brother Allen talked about earlier. I want to be right where you want me to be, right where you want me to be. So if you need to pray about an area, pray about a need, pray about a struggle, pray about a burden, would you do that right now? Would you be willing to do that? Lord, I want to ask you to forgive me. Your voice has become faint. Lord, there were times when I'd hear you and it was as if we were just walking together and I could hear you talk. And it just seems, Lord, like my heart's become so cold that things that used to move me and change me and convict me, they just seem to wash over me. and my heart is getting cold, and I want you to soften my heart, and I want you to keep me close and clean to where I hear your voice, and help me not to become cynical, help me not to become jaded. Help me, Lord, to have a soft heart, a heart that's yours, a heart that's usable and moldable and breakable and pliable, shapeable. I want you to use me, Lord. I want you to use me. I don't want to be like Herod, Lord, where you just refuse to speak. Lord, without your voice, I'm nothing. Without your leadership, I'm nothing. Without your direction, I'm nothing. And so maybe that's your heart tonight. You just want to talk to the Lord about that. You want to pray to him. We're just going to take a minute. Then I'm going to close us in prayer and we'll go. But if that's you tonight, would you just say that to the Lord from your heart? Now I wonder who tonight would say, "Preacher, pray for me. Pray for me. I sense my heart's becoming a little cold and I don't want to go in that direction. I don't want to go down that road. I want the Lord to keep me soft. I want the Lord to keep my heart on fire for him. And I want to listen to him and I want to do what he says. And when he says do something, I want to obey. I want that kind of a relationship with him." Who tonight would say, "Preacher, that's me. Pray for me." Would you slip your hand in the air? Amen. Man, oh man. Amen. Anyone else? Amen. Heavenly Father, tonight we tell you that we love you. It is a privilege, it is an honor to be together in your house and to come before you to worship you and to lift up your name. Lord, would you continue to lead us and direct us and guide us as individuals, as homes, as families, and as a church. We thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you for what you're doing. We thank you for giving us the privilege of knowing you and serving you. And so continue to bless the remainder of this day and this week and prepare our heart, Lord, for all you want to do. Meet every need in this room. Heal every hurt. Those that are in need of a physical touch, we ask you, Lord God, the great physician, that you'd bring divine healing to lives. For those that are struggling with needs, emotional needs, financial needs, relationship needs, whatever it is, Lord, I pray that you, the God that knows everything, would minister to hearts and draw people to yourself. Lord, we love you. We honor you. We worship you. We thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name. And everyone said amen.